Welcome to another episode of Breaking Bread, a safe place to share ideas of positive personal development delivered around food, fitness, and motivation. I'm your host, Horace Jones, the Game Changer. This is your game-changing moment. It only takes a moment to change the game. In today's episode of Breaking Bread, we will be discussing trauma, depression, and its effect on your daily life. Today, my guest is John, a behavior therapy specialist. A behavior practitioner and a personal trainer. We're going to start off with basically just letting him introduce himself. I've got a few questions that I want to ask him. And guys, if you have any questions, please, can you text them in so we can find out a bit more information and we can find out basically where we can get more information. Before I start, guys, I want to say, everybody, I hope you're having a wonderful new year, and I hope, yeah, things are going according to plan. So, I'm going to give it to John. So, John, can you give us a little bit insight about yourself, please?
Right, so my background is a CBT practitioner, cognitive behavioural therapist practitioner, hypnosis practitioner, NLP, neuro-linguistic programming, personal trainer. Experiences, I've worked on about 14 cruise ships, promoting, representing different brands about the concept of well-being and about health, fitness, emotional wealth as well. I've been to many places, I've been lucky to see many countries on my travels. So the past 5 years now, I've really settled back in Manchester, and we're operating my own situation with what I've been doing for the past 10 to 15 years. So up to now, I've done around 26 seminars for the Greater Manchester Police, to over around 1,600 officers. Helping people with different issues, you know, from low-level depression to anxiety to even phobias, weight issues. So everything ties in to everything. So that's how I've been making changes to people's lives, and not just short-term, but long-term as well.
Well, that's excellent. I mean, the first two questions that I wanted to ask you, you kind of already answered, like, where you're originally from, where's your location now? You've kind of answered. What's your occupation and business today? Which is, you've kind of answered already. I don't know if you want to go into depth a bit more about that at all.
My journey started at age 25. I was born in Widenshaw, then moved to Marseille, Rochon. Around 90, when I was at about 1990, and then moved to Merseybank, Charlton, around 97, and then 1999, I moved to Scotland, and that's where things opened up for me, started to change my ways. Age 25, no hope, knew I had to do something, otherwise I don't know where I would be today, so this is what happened. So I moved over to Scotland, and how my fitness career started. I've been training from the age of eight. I've got an older brother who was a top amateur boxer, who used to, for 2 years of my life, teach me about discipline, getting up early mornings, going for them runs, circuit training, pad work. So I've always been into working out. So yeah, age 25, I moved to Scotland, and lucky for me, they had a Glen Eagles Hotel, which is a big golfing resort. They had a staff gym there, so nobody used it. I used it. People used to see me in there, and then they used to ask me questions about, you know, what I can do for this and do for this. Mm-hmm. So I used to invite them to join me to train. And before you know it, one became two, two became three. Before you know it, I was training 30 people. I went to the personnel department of the hotel, and they gave me a £3,000 budget to kick the gym out. And then they started to pay me to train the staff members of the Glen Eagles Hotel, and that's how it started. I didn't have no qualifications at that point, so I thought, right, I better get something here, otherwise I might be in trouble. And that's how my fitness career started.
Okay. So, I'm going to ask you this question. It says, who's been your biggest influence and why?
Right. It depends what different stages of life people appear to you. Okay. You know, like that saying goes, when the student's willing, the teacher appears.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So my first teacher was my older brother. He's the one who taught me about discipline. You know, at age eight, you don't want to get out of your bed, mm-hmm. 4 o'clock in the morning, go running. When you come home from school, he was waiting for me. in the back garden with circuit training pad work. I was playing with friends and mess about. So I had that for 2 years of my life, which really instilled the importance of discipline and how hard work and discipline can overcome talent any day of the week.
Definitely.
So it's my first. It was my first one.
Well done. This one here, number five. If you could choose a game-changing moment in your life amongst many, what moment would you be? Would that be? Sorry.
Again, it's been a few. The first is when I moved to Scotland.
Okay. Wow.
That gave me the distance I needed, the clarity.
Okay.
To see things. And then to start making moves and start to make my life better and to feel better about myself. So I'll say initially, moving to Scotland. The next was working on cruise ships.
Okay. So what made you move to Scotland? Like, how did you get even the confidence to say, you know, you're right, I'm moving tomorrow? Because that's a massive step.
Well, I'd love to take the credit, but I've got another brother who's a chef.
Okay.
He was working at Glen Eagles Hotel.
Okay.
Even before I made the decision to go there, he asked me to keep saying, you know, you're doing anything with your life. Yeah. So he was a chef there. And then finally, I plucked up the courage and he was there. Probably if he wasn't there, I wouldn't have gone.
Yeah. Richard
said, have you ever lost discipline? If yes, how did you recover?
I mean, discipline is like life. Life is never straight. It's up and down. So remember, there's 12 months of a year. You're not going to have the same level of discipline for 12 months of the year. It's impossible. So allow that times where you're not being disciplined, not as disciplined as you'd like, and be with that. But you don't have to stay there as well. So remember, we're not going for perfection. It doesn't exist. What we're going is consistent. So you can be consistent 80% of the year and then you're winning. So we're not going for perfection. So remember, you can have those down times. It's just the way it is, because us human beings are emotional creatures. So life affects us in one way or another. So we're going to have those downtowns. So don't resist it, just be with it, see what the message is telling you, and then get back up and you go again, and you keep going. I live by the 80-20 rule. 80% of the time I do the right thing, 20% of the time I allow for whether I haven't got the motivation or just want to live life, because we've only got one life, you want to enjoy it as well.
Excellent. Before I ask you question number six, I want to say hello to a few people. So who have we got there waving? We've got a few people there.
Daniel Andrews.
Mustafa, who else is there?
Can't see the rest.
Can you bring them down? Can you throw them down there? I want to say hello to a few people, a few thumbs up. Can you bring the line down now? So again, guys, I want to say just a big thank you to everyone that's tuning in today. Thank you very much. I want to move on to question number six, because I think this is where we're going to start getting to the concept of how things start changing. So question number six says, what insights can you tell us about personal trauma, depression, and the effects on one's daily life?
Right, so, I mean, if you look at trauma is not... When I say trauma, it doesn't have to be anything physical or huge. It's what's traumatic to us. It's what we hold traumatic. So what I hold traumatic to me might be different to what you hold, and vice versa. So our trauma, well, most of it will come from the childhood.
Mm-hmm.
And from that trauma and how we hold it within, we will create behaviours and coping mechanisms to cope with what we've been through or experienced.
Mm-hmm.
And it's those coping behaviours then, which then can grow into adult issues and problems. So from the trauma, we create something, internalise it.
Mm-hmm.
We create a behaviour from it.
Mm-hmm.
Some people may create addictions, alcohol. I mean, I know for me, my personal journey, I mean, I started drinking when I was 8 because of the environment I came from.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was soothing my pain with alcohol, which then led out other things, and then stopped going to school at a certain age. So I lost a lot through alcohol because I had nobody there to teach me. So that's how it can affect life. And what happens is we grow up with those coping behaviours. And as we get older, our situation changes or can change. And we still hold on to the old behaviours though. And those behaviours doesn't fit into our current present life.
Yeah.
So it doesn't fit anymore, but we still hold on to it.
Mm-hmm.
But we keep with it, we don't change it. It's like a phone or a laptop or a computer when it says update systems.
We update our system.
We carry on with the old system, expecting it to work, and it doesn't, because we're in a different situation.
I wonder why we're not getting the results.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
So this is where I help people to make peace and let go.
Because I mean, I this for me is a massive topic, because I've known that some of my childhood issues as I've been affecting me until when I kind of like started analysing, like, why am I doing this? Like, why am I like this? You know, why am I like, you know, off the drop of a coin, I want to look at violence first before looking at another situation first. And the things that, like you said, you know, your environment plays a massive part, because if you're in an environment where all you can see is fight or flight, automatically, even though you want to change, that's going to be your first impression, is to basically fight. So understanding how to kind of like deal with it. But I think the big thing is admitting that you've kind of got a problem. Would you say a problem, or would you say, I don't know, is the problem the right word? I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, issues. I mean, a lot of us think our issues, it's just unique to us. We don't realise everybody's got them.
Mm-hmm.
And we become embarrassed about it.
When
we become embarrassed about it, mm-hmm. we want to talk about it, we keep it to ourselves. Mm-hmm. And this mm-hmm. is where the concept is, it is good to talk. Because mm-hmm. if you don't talk, nothing changes.
Yeah.
So they hold it within. And while they hold it within, they create like a false identity. So okay. the identity or the false mask, what they portray to the world. Mm-hmm. I'm okay, nothing wrong.
Alison Scott said that's so true.
And then when they go home, mm-hmm. when the world is not watching, the mask slips and they're back to who they really are.
Okay, yeah.
And then from there we can create, you know, coping behaviours like maybe alcohol or drugs or watching mm-hmm. pointless television or on social media or something. Because we try to soothe our pain, our mm-hmm. emotional mm-hmm. pain. We try to soothe. So we're looking for these things which then can create its own problem.
So
some people overeat. And this is why I help people with weight issues. Mm-hmm. I call it emotional weight loss, where everybody's got a relationship with food.
Okay.
Some people don't realise they've got that relationship. Some people are out of boredom, out of loneliness, the reward. When people are stressed, they reward the stress with a bottle of wine.
And then
we don't know where that leads. So imagine mm-hmm. over time that one bottle becomes two, some becomes mm-hmm. three. Before you know it, you can have a problem right mm-hmm. there. Some people may go to drugs.
Mm-hmm.
So this is why it's just understanding, because remember that when it comes to something like weight loss, the weight is just a symptom. We need to go, what's supporting that weight? Because we won't go to that, then the weight will look after itself.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of people then jump to diets and stuff like that for the answers, and we know long term crash diets, at this time of year is going to be so bright. You get the celebrities selling whatever they're selling.
Definitely.
I always, when I do my seminars and I write the word diet on the board and I cross out the T, what does it read? Die.
Because
mm-hmm. the moment you choose to go on a diet is the day you choose to go to war with your body, and you will never beat nature. Mm-hmm. Your body will always win. It's called rebound weight, so you never get that long-term
solution. I mean, one of the things that I went to stress today was like how the trauma effect can affect, like, for example, you getting a job, family, things like relationships. Things like even down to friendships.
Richard says, when you had the police force as a client, was there a common theme that officers had regarding these, like, anxiety, trauma, or depression?
Yeah, so I did lots of 26 seminars, 1,600 officers. Out of those 1,600, I would say around 200 came to me for a consultation. So I do a seminar, then I give them the opportunity to come to see me for consultation if there was anything they think they need to change. And at least 90% of the people who saw me, what they thought was the problem wasn't the problem. So it's a symptom of a deeper problem. And majority of it was going back to childhood, the past. So if you're stuck in the past, you cannot move forward. So when the future comes, all you're looking at is the past. You can never come forward. So it's about resolving that first, because obviously, being in the police, it's going to come with its own stresses that you can't control. So I get them to focus on the things they can control, which then puts them in a better position to handle the stress which comes with the job.
Makes sense, definitely, man. So I'm going to go on to question number 7. It says, what tools can one use to break a cycle of anxiety and depression?
Right, it's understanding thoughts. Now, experts say we've got up to 60,000 thoughts a day we have.
Wow.
Now, all those 60,000, 80% are negative and 95% are repetitive, repeated thoughts.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So if you look at the thoughts is not really the problem. The problem is the thinker. It's how the thinker make up the thoughts.
Of course.
So this is where meditation is an excellent tool to use, because
mm-hmm.
it really does get you to think of your thoughts and reframe them in a different way. And it's not about reacting to the thoughts. It's just about seeing them, because thoughts is like clouds. They come, then they go. They never stick.
Yeah.
Or they may stick for a little while, then eventually they clear. But if we don't identify with that, the thoughts go. But a lot of people identify it and give it attention. Then that thoughts and exacerbates. And then people act on the thought. And before you know it, they create issues like anxiety or maybe depression. Another one as well is the messages of the thoughts. You know, remember, emotions, thoughts, they're messages. But we don't get the message. So it's just like driving a car, you know, we drive a car, the red light comes on the dashboard, that's a message to say there's something wrong with the car. We've got one or two options, we can just ignore it, throw the coat over it,
or we can
take it into a garage and get it fixed. So when people with a negative thought, they then lead to negative emotions, negative behaviours, negative actions, negative results.
Wow.
They're not getting the message behind it, they're just acting from it. Hello, my name is Sean, I've got anxiety now. Well, no, you're not.
Yeah.
You know, nobody's born with it.
For real.
You know, and as well, a lot of people get their emotional need met through their negative emotions. So somebody, I mean, I've met a few, not all, but a few people with, say, depression, anxiety. In that moment, they're getting their emotional need met, which is love and attention.
Yeah.
Because it's something which was lacking. But they're going to a negative to achieve it.
Okay.
So a good way is to, this is where goals is a good thing as well, implementing goals. So, okay, what positive way can we get your emotional need met?
And
now your life is going in a different direction, and eventually you're going to start to feel the way you want to feel about yourself, and your life is going to be the way you think it should be, you know? So this is why these thoughts and getting
a
message.
I've just seen a question, but what's Richard saying there?
Is there any book or books that inspired you in a positive way?
Jeez, my first book, 2009... I was on a cruise ship called Ocean Village 2. One of the best advice I got from a gentleman called Dominic Nell from South Africa. Discussions, you know, and he said, John, the best advice I can ever give you is read. And up to that point, me and the concept of reading, I thought, behaviour yourself, read.
Yeah.
Most things, I read muscle magazines, not entertainment or something, but something which you can grow from. So the first book I got was a book called Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill.
Wow.
Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill.
Gosh.
I must have read that about, once I read it, I couldn't put it down.
Yeah, it resonated. Yeah,
I was thinking, wait, can you think and grow rich? Wait,
Well, I'm glad he said that, you know. Because I'm going to jump in what you say. Because I think for me as well, it was a time when I was working on my old job. And a friend of mine said, you know, read. But you're saying you've got to specifically think about what you're reading. It's not just about reading, it's about specifically what you're reading. So when I start working about self-development books, self-help books, and I was using that time at dinner time. So instead of dinner time in the canteen, I was sitting out with everybody else. I took myself away in the corner, where everyone was looking at me thinking, oh, he's weird. Why is he not mixing with us? Why is he not mixing with us? And them weeks of me sitting in that corner and reading and getting my head down, that started my journey. That started my journey of understanding that I can be more than what I am right now. I can be more than what I am. And, you know, looking back now, this is going back, what, 2 years? Since then, and that's just reading, guys. I mean, so going back to what he says, Napoleon Hill, Think and Grow Rich. I'm telling you guys, you know what I mean, it's one massive thing to try and teach the younger generation is to read. There was an old saying, put it in the books, the fools won't find it. You know what I mean? That was an old saying. I'm not going to finish off basically. But that's what the saying was basically, put it in the books, the fools won't find it. So that is where to get the information, guys. And if you want to build, whether it's inspirational, motivational, you know, there is so much self-help books out there that you can see too. But I'm going to ask him this one. So are there any myths about trauma or depression that you can tell us about? Now, did I just read that one there?
Is it myths?
Yeah, myths, yeah. Did I read that one again, or was it number nine? No, so why is it healthy childhood development important, and at what age is it crucial?
So fundamentally it's important because the child, like an adult, but especially the child, we've got emotional needs. So some of the needs could be significance, safety, love, attention, connection. So if any of those is out, it can lead to issues. and it leaves a void. So suppose the little girl who was born. Now remember, when we're born as well, it's like our mind is the disk drive. Our parents is the computer. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, the computer comes with viruses.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. No, for real.
And some of these virus sticks can lead into, you know, mm-hmm. adult issues. So the little girl who's born, who's been one of the emotional need, is to feel worthy of attention, but it's not getting it in the environment from the parents, father, mm-hmm. mother, but usually it's the father, you know. As they grow up, what can potentially can happen is then they start looking outside themselves for that need, meaning going to destructive relationships. Mm-hmm. And usually the structured relationships, the males they go with, or females, they've got the same characteristics of the father. So they're living out the childhood. And it's a game they're never going to win. So after one destructive relationship, they may find another, then another, before you know it now, she's experiencing physical abuse, emotional abuse. Now, to cope with that, maybe then she goes to alcohol to soothe the issues, yeah, to soothe the pain. And then on all holes of problems, it's just started again. This is how important getting the emotional need of the child met. Mm-hmm. Now, emotional need doesn't mean spoiling a child. It doesn't mean the child doesn't always, not just realise they are loved, but they actually feel it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They receive it. Mm-hmm. So when mm-hmm. they do grow up, because we all do it, we get to a certain age, we start questioning our childhood. There we can look back and know that the way their parents taught them and parent them, it holds up to scrutiny.
Okay.
So they can look back and say, yeah, my parents were cool.
Yeah,
like what they did.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. but if that is lacking, a void is missing. So this is why I say the most important relationship is the relationship with the parents, because if that relationship is wrong, on some level, in some way, your life will be about your relationship with your parents.
No, of course, but well, this is where I'm saying it's a great topic, because you know, I think all of us somehow, when we do look back within our childhood, there are bits of our childhood that we can honestly say, pinpoint certain things about how we're acting now. It's because, you know, going way back. And a lot of us won't want to look way back to find an answer to the situations that you're going through now. And it's like you said, you know, like, you know, if, for example, like you say, as a baby, if a baby's crying in a problem, that baby's not getting the attention, sooner or later that baby realise that there's no help coming, so then that can trigger off certain things in that baby. And another thing whereas most of us do as adults, well, I'm going to give my kid everything. So you buy your kids this and that, but the basic foundation what that kid needs, he still ain't getting. But yet you bought him the mountain bike, the trainers, the clothes, the da-da-da-da-da-da, but yet the foundation of what that person needed, they're not met. So. Yeah. We need.
The missed the most valid lesson. Kids don't want to see it; they want to feel it. Mm-hmm. Remember, we're emotional creatures; they want to feel it. So our parents potentially can buy the kids love, mm-hmm. because not giving what the kid really needs, which is time. Mm-hmm. And that's all the kid wants. Just want your time.
Yeah,
the reason. Yeah. You just want your time. Mm-hmm. Now I've got a 4-year-old, and he doesn't know the concept of flashy trainers and bikes and computers and all that. Mm-hmm. You just want, daddy played with me. Mm-hmm. And guess what? That's what he's going to remember.
No, of course.
Daddy spent time with me.
Yeah, of course. Memories.
That meant daddy loved me.
Yeah, and of course. Yeah, it's about creating memories, isn't it? But creating memories in a way, like you said, is the foundation that you're hoping to build is the foundation that them kids are going to use for their own kids.
That's right.
So as much as we want to buy our children all these expensive items and all these expensive televisions, we need to look at, like you said, making sure that child knows what the concept of love is.
That's right. Because we know history has got a way of repeating itself. So our parents' mm-hmm. issues, they bring into their adult world. But mm-hmm. they got that from their parents, and their parents got that from their parents. And
yep.
It goes back many decades.
Yep.
So now this is why I'm glad that I've created change, so I don't have to repeat old ways. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, create a new way of being, you know, as a human being, as a father, you know, somebody who's trying to help people to, you know, change in certain areas in their life, mm-hmm. you know, and this is what it's about.
What's that question saying?
That's true. Time is so valuable with parents at a young age.
Yeah. Remember, there's that saying, time is more valuable than money, because you can always get more money, but you can never get more time. You know, once it's gone, it's gone, it's done.
And these quotes here, I'm telling you, these are quotes I hear in the books. All the times I read, and this is said, it's Foundation is so important. Think about anything in life. Without a good foundation, whether it's a building, if you try and build a building, you concentrate on just on the roof and the middle section, but the foundation is not right. Eventually, that building is gonna fall down. Again, with anything, you know, like for some of us, like for example, for me, I can probably not train for 3-4 months, but I can still go back in it because I've got good foundations. Foundations are so important. What's that question Richard's asking there, please?
What motivates you today?
What motivates me? Being a good parent and just being the best I can possibly be in the areas of my life. Because remember, we've all got areas of life we need to improve on. You know, it's like a mountain with no top. It's something you're going to keep climbing and climbing and climbing. So every day, what area can I improve in? You know, whether it's health, fitness, can I put more of the right fuel inside my body today than yesterday? Can I spend that little bit more time with my children than I did yesterday? You know, so yeah, there's all different areas you can improve in, spiritual, physical, emotional, educational, you know. So yeah, there's many ways. So always look within yourself to see the areas where you can improve. And if you do need help with those areas, seek help.
Definitely. So question 11 says, how can this affect one's personal business or organization and relationships? So it's going back to the trauma, like how can trauma affect, like, yes, like you've been in a relationship.
Yeah.
Or you even been in a job. Because yeah. I feel as if, like, if you was moved around a lot as a kid,
yeah,
maybe when you get a job, you can't stay in that one job.
Yeah.
Because you don't know how to stay in that one job. Yeah. Maybe again, like, you know, the relationship that your parents had was a bit upside down. So now you've had relationships, now they're upside down, or it could be even a friendship. So like, how does these things
affect these areas there? So whatever trauma or events we've gone through as a child, it can create certain belief systems. And one belief system, what I get a lot of the time when I'm helping people emotionally, is to, I'm not good enough, low self-esteem. Mm-hmm. So if you're carrying low self-esteem, and the concept, remember, concept is not real. Mm-hmm. It's made up, that I'm not good enough. And then you're going to bring that old identity and belief system into your current world, into your job, into your workplace, or create your own business. You're always going to find a reason not to take that next step. Mm-hmm. So you might get that one step where, right, I'm going to do this. And then the old belief system kicks into play. And then you take that 2 steps back. Mm-hmm. Or another way what can happen is maybe you will have half-heartedly try something. Yep, or don't try at all. Mm-hmm. Either way, you're proving yourself right. I'm not good enough.
Yeah.
So it's like we're our own fortune tellers, if you like. We try to prove ourselves right. So yeah, I'm not good enough.
Or we may
even try and achieve a goal, something which is unachievable, just to prove ourselves right.
We can't. Yeah.
See, I told you I'm not good enough. Look, mm-hmm. I can't achieve that.
You see, you know, and I swear, as you're talking now, I'm like thinking in my brain, is this guy talking about me or what? is he talking about me here? You know what I mean? I'm like getting panicky. But it's so right. It's absolutely like, you know, and until when I started getting into like reading and understanding certain concept of life, I was kind of thinking, oh, you know, I can't do that, or I can't achieve that, or it's too big, it's too small, or da da da, no. And one of the things, one of the quotes that I listened to, it says something like, learn to bring more value to the marketplace. So it's like, okay, then you work at a job, right? Or say you get a job and you're the cleaner. Why can't you be the manager? You can be the manager. You know, first of all, you've got to have the belief concept. You've got to visualize yourself. You've got to understand time. But at the same time, if you've not got a good belief system to say that you can change from this to this, then you're always going to look at it as, like you said, oh, I can't do that. Oh, it's too big and da da da. And for example, my own family do that, and sometimes they don't do it as a bad thing. I think they do it as a more of like, oh, they're kind of like scared. They kind of like don't want you to, like, I won't say fail, but they don't want you to like fall off. So they say to you, oh, you can't do that.
Can I say something? Yeah, of course. That's so true. And they do it unconsciously. Mm-hmm. So what happened is, remember, us, we think of, when we give advice to people, we think as ourselves. Mm-hmm. So as self, if we've got a low self-esteem or don't think we're good enough, our advice will be based from that.
Yeah.
So it's unconscious what they're doing. Mm-hmm. And they're doing it out of love. Mm-hmm. What they try to do is protection. Mm-hmm. Some don't do that, mm-hmm. just in case.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
And this is where I mean, if you look at the word fear, the false evidence appearing real, the false evidence appearing real, mm-hmm. you know, and I mean, a dictionary term, is a term for fear is the anticipation of pain. So when you look at the word anticipation, that's more future.
Yeah, yeah.
So now we know the future isn't real now. Yeah. So we're not operating from reality.
Yeah.
And that's where a lot of anxiety is. It's future, the projecting. So yeah. Anxiety can be seen as something what's happened in the past, which we live through today.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
We're holding on for the future.
Of course.
So we're never free of it.
Yeah, absolutely.
So yeah, so this is what it's about. It's cutting free of those behavioural patterns and scripts which has been created from childhood and let go of that and creating a new identity.
Mm-hmm.
One is I can, it is possible.
So one of the things that I want to stress, like, what's the first way to go about finding out if my past is affecting my present? Like what are the signs?
Are you still acting out like you're still a child?
Victor said, what's your biggest challenge today and how are you approaching it?
Okay.
My biggest challenge today, how I'm approaching it? Probably now is to... Especially with the COVID hitting and the lockdowns, it's probably have a more of an online presence and reach a wider, bigger audience, because I know a lot of people are going through it, feeling it, but a lot of us not talking about it. They still don't want to, because remember, some people think feeling vulnerable is a weakness. No, it's not. Mm-hmm. How are you supposed to get better? Without struggle, there's no progress.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my biggest challenge is now is trying to have more of an online presence and coming up with different stuff online so I can really work and maybe create a community you know, of like-minded people who's not afraid to speak about what they're going through, their issues, what they've been through. I mean, this always stands out for me. I was on 2014, I was working on the Queen Mary 2 cruise ship. I did a seminar, 200 people came to the seminar on the cruise ship.
Yeah.
200 people came. From that, they get the chance to book in for consultations. I mean, it must have impacted a lot of people because out of that 200 people, around between 30 to 40 people booked in for a consultation with me. Mm-hmm. And this one lady always stand out for me. She was from London and wanted to lose weight. She had type 2 diabetes, high blood pressure, other metabolic diseases, clinical obese, successful woman, millionaire.
Mm-hmm.
At the stage of life, when she was about 54, 55, she was looking for love, something to share her life with, a success with. And she was brave enough to share a story with me. Age 8, she was raped by her uncle.
Mm-hmm.
So subconsciously, she ran to food for protection. Because in her mind, she thought, if I make myself as attractive as possible, this could never happen to me again. She used food as protection. So she was on the ship for 2 weeks. So we started the process on the ship because she was only on it for 2 weeks. She spent a week with me every day for 3 or 4 hours. We were going through everything. So we did a combination of CPT, cognitive behavioral therapy, timeline therapy, hypnosis. We did working out, meditation. By the time she left the ship, she had a workout program, what she could do at home, because she was too embarrassed to go to the gym.
Mm-hmm.
Sorted the nutrition out for her. We set goals. And now one of the goals was every 2 weeks, she would email me with the results she was getting from what we created, the strategy we created. Mm-hmm. Now, for the first 4 or 5 months, she was emailing me, and she was doing great. I think at the five-month mark, she lost 3.5 stone. She even joined a dating website.
Mm-hmm.
Then after after the 5 month mark, she stopped emailing me.
Mm-hmm.
So I can only assume that she doesn't need
me.
And that's the aim is to give people the tools to go out and do it themselves. Because no matter what, we've got to walk our path ourselves. There's no people there who will support, but we've got to walk it.
This is where
I always say, you know, I'm the tour guy, but she's got to take the journey.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, before I ask you, basically, because the thing is, I want to give these views where they can find you, what information they can find. But the last question says, are there any personal or professional challenges in your own life and how do you manage it?
Personal challenges in my life? It's ongoing. It's how to control your emotions when you need to control it. And this is where I've got a lot of respect for, especially the sports stars, you know, the elite sports stars, because in that moment, they can control what they need to control to see whatever they need to see it through.
Yeah.
There's a certain reason why Tiger Woods has won, was it 15 majors?
Yeah.
You know, Roger Federer has won Wimbledon so many times, Rafa Nadal, and you know, Michael Jordan, and all these great people, you know, because when in that moment, they can control this, they can control that mental chatter.
No, of course, man. Yeah, can show
you know. So that was probably my biggest challenge every day is, you know, when the moment comes, can I, you know, see through what I need to see through? Can I control what I need to control? Now, remember, it comes in many disguises, it comes in many ways for us all. It's the same thing. And fear, controlling our fears. And I always say fear is your best friend. You just got to know how to use it. But a lot of people don't. They allow the fear to overwhelm them. And this is where then they run to the labels, you know, hello, my name is John, I've got anxiety. Sometimes you've got to stop running and face what we need to face, because once you face it, it's gone, it's over with, it's done.
But sometimes we I think we do have the concept to, we want to be diagnosed, don't we? We want answers, we want someone to say, yeah, you've got this.
Yeah, we feel comfortable.
We can sleep good at that, I can sleep good tonight because it says to me that I've got depression, so everything's good, I sleep.
And you know, in part why that is because there's some people out there who just want to take responsibility. They're rather easy to take something or have that label and operate. It's not me. It's my anxiety, it's my depression, it's not me.
No,
it's not. You know, so when I do these consultations, whatever it may be, say for weight loss or whatever, I get them to go to the board and, you know, ask him up to this point, you know, well, why haven't you achieved what you want to achieve physically? And then it comes out, you know, all the reasons why you haven't, you know, work, you haven't got time, kids, this, that. And, you know, you let them go on. And before you know it, they've got a list, top 15, 20. <You know? laughs> and they're standing at the side of the board and they're looking at me and saying, it's not me, it's not me. So I said, okay, you know, there's a problem with that list. You're not on it, so let's scrub all this off. I'll write two letters. Let's write me on there. Because you control your universe. Remember, it's not what happens, it's what you choose to do about it. So I'm not saying that's a lie. You're going through all that. However, there's 160 hours in one week. So how can you tell me you haven't got time? It's impossible.
Of course.
It's just you're not creating the time. So let's work together so we can create the time to do what we need to do. So in 6 months, 9 months, a year, won't be having the same conversation about your weight anymore.
Absolutely. I mean, the thing that kind of made me laugh, and again, it was one of the inspirational speakers I listened to, and it said something like, when he went to his mentor, the mentor says, have you got any goals in the list? And he goes, no. And he goes, oh, where is it, in the car? So he goes, no. He goes, well, that's your first problem already then. So you've got no goals. So how do you expect to get to where you're going if you've got no goals? And then he says, why are you in this state? And then he starts saying, well, I started blaming the system. I'm blaming the state. I'm blaming my job. And it was, like you said, it's everything, he's blaming everything apart from it. He would not say himself. So it's like you said, you know, sometimes we as individuals, we have to kind of like start taking responsibility and start saying, you know what, this starts with me. There's another big thing I've been looking at is like, change starts with you. Change starts with you or within. If you want change, start changing you first. And once you start changing you, then everything around you will start changing. But don't expect everything outside you to change, but yet you're still coming with the same thing.
Yeah, so true. We look outside ourselves for the answers. We've got all the answers in here and in here. Mm-hmm. All you need to do is get them out. Mm-hmm. Get a piece of paper, write down what you want to improve. Mm-hmm. Okay, what steps do I need to take? What are you going to start with?
Absolutely.
Okay, after a couple of weeks, revisit it. What results have you got from that? Has it worked? You can see any changes, any improvements? If not, okay, let's go to the next one. Mm-hmm. And before you know it, you create your own formula for change. You know, people like us, we can give you the outlines, but we're all different.
Yeah, of course.
So you've got to find what's going to work for you and something which is sustainable you can keep to. Because remember, one part of success is consistency. You know, nobody won the Olympics training once a week. Usain Bolt can become the fastest man in history. Training once a month.
Consistency.
Richard said, great advice. How can anyone contact you? And do you have a website? And Tina said, definitely wise words, guys. Change starts with you. Also, don't just wait for Mondays or New Year's to start.
Where can the viewers find you? What social media sites you're on, and tell us, where can we find you?
Website www.johnpommells.co.uk. You can get me on Facebook, on Instagram, WhatsApp, whatever. But I mean, what I'm looking forward to do is, now we're onto the second lockdown, I'm gonna create maybe a platform where, for 1 month, free of charge, once a week, for 30-40 minutes on Zoom, we can meet up and let's talk and share each other's stories and share stories and know what we're going through, because I guarantee you, other people will be going through it as well. Mm-hmm. It's just whoever's brave enough to talk about it.
No, of course, yeah.
Because
it
just takes one, and before you know it, second one talked, third one talked, and now we've got the community to make real change. Mm-hmm. So this is what I'm be looking to do in the next probably 2 weeks. So stand by for that. And I think that's where I'm going to start my social media presence, by creating something like that. There's a little platform. So again, free of charge, for 1 month, free of charge. Then anything after that, if you want to carry on, then we can sort something out. But free of charge, 1 month, 30, 40 minutes, once a week. Let's create something online so we can talk about, you know, things what we shouldn't be embarrassed to talk about. This is what it's about. Mm-hmm. Got to get it out there. Because if not, we suppress it and it's going to come out in other ways.
Well, I'm going to say something now, because I know a lot of people don't value things that are free. I think we've got something in our heads that tells us it's free, it's rubbish.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to tell you this now, guys. Listen, when this young man starts doing what he's doing, I'm going to put it on my page myself. I'm going to put it out there to say what platform he's on. And I'm begging you guys, find the time to find the time. Simple as find the time to find the time, because sometimes we don't appreciate what's out there free, and it's only when somebody's saying it costs this much now, that's when you want to jump on it. So, you know, advice sometimes is out there, and sometimes the advice may not suit you, but maybe it can suit your next of kin or your friends or your family. So sometimes just getting, it's like people say, what's the message? What's the message? There's no use in getting the message if you can't relate the message back. So one of the things I'm going to say to you guys, it's like even like this situation that we're on about, we're talking about this topic here now. Now, it was mad how this topic became. John knocked my door the other day to sell me hair after Christmas and whatnot. I was like, wow, what's going on? Before you know it, bam, bam, bam. And it's like, you know, I'm a massive true believer of... you meet people for a reason, and things happen for a reason. I happened to be in, because I was going to go out 10 minutes from when he knocked the door. So for me, it's like, things happen for a reason. You're probably seeing this video here for a reason. Now, are you going to act on it, or are you just going to see it as like, well, it's one of them things, and I'm just going to forget about it and call it a day?
Richard said, you were doing Breaking Bread for a month free. And then he also said, awesome, find the time to find the time.
There you go. So guys, like I said, this is John. Again, find him, find information. And again, I'm telling you, the reason why I thought this was a great topic, because even like now, I'm still challenged. I have challenging issues that I know are inside me from my childhood. And if somebody came to me 10 years ago, 20 years ago, and says, Horace, the reason why you like this, or the reason why you think like this, is because of X, Y, Z, that would have answered a lot of questions. And that would have probably saved me a lot of heartache as well. It would have made me understand certain things and how I am. So again, guys, information is great. And especially if you know what to do with it. And if you've got someone that can draw you out a roadmap and help you on your way to your path, it makes things much easier. Now, guys, we're going to go in the kitchen now. We're going to start cooking. I'm going to do a quick, simple recipe. Today I'm cooking pasta with broccoli, with a little bit of coconut sauce and bay leaves. Again, check up the nutrition that's in broccoli. Check up the nutrition that's in the bay leaves. I'm using brown pasta because I'm trying to come away from the white, and the white's bleached. Again, guys, do your own research. Do not take everything I say. Do your own research. So we're going to transfer our time now into the kitchen. Quick little recipe. And yeah, we're still going to start with a topic. So again, guys, any questions that you want to ask, keep throwing out the questions. John's here to answer the questions. And if I can answer questions myself, I'm going to answer the questions, guys. So again, we're going to go in the kitchen. We're going to start the cooking. So yeah, give me a couple of seconds for the quick transformation. Let's go. So let's change that round. I'm going to have to change that around and go and grab a seat in there, John. I've got you a seat already, yeah?
Nice.
Do you want to come close there? So again, guys, I've got some mushrooms, spring onion, thyme, got my broccoli, I got my turmeric. Now, I thought about putting this in because, guys, this is this is another good fit. Again, guys, research it, yeah? This is supposed to be a great concept for your health. I've gone to the pink salt. Even though I'm trying to come away from this, I heard that the pink salt's supposed to be great. Got my brown pasta here, and I've got my coconut milk from here. Again, guys, this is again under a fiver. We're looking at probably £3 here, so it's well under a fiver.
Can I say something about the turmeric? It's a great anti-inflammatory. So if you've got any inflammation, this is what nature created.
There you go.
Remember, nature made no mistake when it came to our foods. Man came along and messed up our foods.
Well, there you go, guys. You've got it. You've got it in a nutshell. And
exactly. Nature had it covered.
It did.
The man said, "No, we're right. You're wrong. You've been blaming us." And now they've messed up our food supply. And look now, obesity, type 2 diabetes, all the rest of these metabolic diseases. So always trust in nature.
Oh, and Richie said, "What's a quid?"
What's a quid?
Quid's a pound.
It's a pound. So again, it's my accent. So. Again, it's just about, guys, understanding that you can still get all the nutrients that you need for a low budget. And again, I'm trying to get fresh food. There is nothing wrong with getting it frozen, but I always try and go fresh. You can go fresh, it just saves a lot of things. So you can go fresh, you can. And again, guys, I'm going back to the concept. Instead of me using these, I'm now trying to use this. Okay? So I know, like I said, traditionally, we're being brought up on all these, you know, chicken seasoning. And again, guys, like I says, every one of these has salt in it. Right, this again, like I said, this is nature. So they've got back to learning how
that's
to...
That's a great diuretic, natural diuretic. So you've got blood pressure issues, which is stemming from the kidneys. This is a great thing. Natural. Remember, nature made no mistakes. They knew what it was doing.
Knowledge right here, guys. Knowledge right here, I'm telling you. Kicking up some knowledge. So I'm going to boil my kettle. Just to cook up my pasta quick. We're running out of time. Cook my pasta quick. And then, like I said, I'm gonna cook off my mushrooms and my thyme and whatnot. So I'm gonna start doing this now quick. And then get my mushrooms, my pasta on the go. And then we can take it from there. So yeah, let me just put this on here now. Put a little bit of oil in this. And again, guys, olive oil. Go and try and get away from the cheap oil if you can, or if you can, not use any oil, don't use any oil. But again, try and get away from it. So again, we're going to throw the thyme in. Can you see me here?
Yeah.
Again, guys, like I said, natural seasoning, natural flavouring. That's what it's about. Do what it's doing. These. Again, guys, you can get different kinds of mushrooms. Can't really remember what these ones are called, but yeah, you don't have to get these ones. You can get the whiter ones, the smaller ones,
the big ones,
bigger ones. Yeah, whichever you prefer. So what we've got 10 minutes, so I'm trying to cook this meal here.
Has anybody got any questions for me?
Yeah, any questions there, guys?
Any questions? Any issues with, I don't know, weight? Any got any weight loss goals for 2021?
Richard said, John, what are some of your favourite healthy dishes for breakfast, lunch, dinner and why? Richard said, what are some of your favourite healthy dishes for breakfast, dinner and lunch and why?
I mean, there's a lot of healthy dishes out there and I haven't got no cookbook, but what I say is this, eat real food and not too much. Once you can reduce calories and keep your hormones balanced, meaning not spiking that insulin too much, because that's what leads to the weight gain. So we spike that insulin too much and then we get the crash. And usually that crash comes about mid-morning where we feel a bit sluggish, but we're craving sugar because we put too much sugar in for our breakfast. And before you know it, we're back on that up and down roller coaster. And throughout the day, we're up, we're down, we're crashing. And then guess what happens when you come to your evening meal? It becomes the biggest of the day now, because we're starving, because we haven't been feeding our body with nutrition. So remember, just balance the protein with the good carbs, the complex carbs. Remember, the carbs with fiber. There's a reason why nature put fiber in carbohydrate. And there's a reason why man took it out. One of the issues of man taking it out, or one of the concerns of us human beings, is now lack of bowel movement, bloatedness. Remember, true health is our body digesting and passing out our waste. If we can't pass out our waste, then we cannot be healthy. So real food.
Doretta said, eat little and often, has to be nutritious and healthy. Think colourful in your plate, a balanced diet.
Great, yeah, great advice. But remember, not one rule fits all. So find an eating pattern and plan what fits your lifestyle. So it's small and often, works, and great, carry on with it. Sometimes three square meals actually work for some people. Or some people are athletes who train a lot. They train around the workouts. So it all depends.
So for
smells
me, guys,
good.
For me, again, like it says, it's best to think about, like it says in it, eat well, make sure, like you said, I mean, I think your digestive system should be telling you, like, how you feel. Like I used to eat meat, and I know when I took the changeover, I seen a difference in my size straight away. It's like all the muscle mass left, but I still felt very, very well. Energy, still had all the lots of energy. But what I did feel is if like the bloatiness of gone, and the concept of like me, my digestive system seemed to like work a lot, a lot better. So you know, a lot of people say, you know, drink lots of water and drink what. But I still think no matter how much water you drink, if your diet's not right, your digestive system's not going to right. No matter how much water you drink. So it's the balance of basically understanding what to eat, like I said, and when to eat, and trying to like, you know, like you said, understanding the different times of day. Like, for example, if you're having a big breakfast, but you know you're going to sit down at the office all day long and then have chocolate bars all day long, then how are you going to get rid of that concept? So you got to be a bit more versatile.
I mean, when it comes to bloatiness as well, the two main causes of bloatiness, the two causes really, is gluten and dairy. So if you're eating these things and your belly's swelling up, or you're getting congested, blocked sinuses, that's a good indication to cut out the dairy. So if this resonates with anybody, I challenge you, just cut it out for 2 weeks and see if you feel different. If your bloatiness goes down, you're not getting the bloatiness as much. If you are, you already know what's causing it. Now remember, gluten is in most stuff. It's in a lot of stuff, especially the cereals, the breads.
Wow.
Okay, so maybe do that if bloatiness is a concern. If remember, bowel movements is so important, and a lot of us are too embarrassed to talk about it. You know, and I can appreciate that. It's not first date material, is it? You know, hello, my name is John, I'm a bit gassy. It's not about that. But it's so important, because remember, true health is the size of your stomach.
Yeah, but so on a real, how much times a day or a week should you be going to the toilet?
I mean, you should be going at least every day now. I've heard the concept about when a baby's born, when you feed it, you know, it goes to have a nappy change. And as we get older, as adults, it changes. Where I know there's some of my clients, when they came to see me, they were struggling to go once every 4 days. Now that's a problem. That's a problem. They're getting backed up now. Now there's toxic load, especially with meat. Remember, the time in to time out of red meat in your body is 72 hours, and that's rotting inside.
Wow.
So if you are eating meat, we're saying not to. Well, I'm not. But if you are eating meat, then give that clearance. So maybe eat red meat twice a week, at the beginning and at the end of the week.
Doretta said, Horace, you always look well. This is down to your training as well as healthy diet. Exercise flushes the system, encourages the enzymes to work the digestive system effectively. gluten-free products, or Iron Ducks even. And then Richard says, does diet differ with age and gender? If yes, how? And then 2 to 3 times if you eat fiber, roughage and exercise.
So I'm going to go back to... I'm going to go back to what that lady said again. What's her name again, sorry?
Loretta,
I'm going to go back to that, what she said. You're absolutely right. I've been in fitness for a very long time. I've been in fitness, I think, from all as a kid. And that's what's interesting about foundation. Foundation is so good thing to have with anything in life. So because I've got a good foundation, like I said, I can stop fitness for like 3-4 months and still go back into it. But my diet still plays a massive part, because there is times when, you know, that belly starts rising. I'm like, well, what's going on here? Why is the belly rising? That's because, again, because I'm putting in more than I'm exercising. So you still have to have the balance. Whether you got exercise, there still has to be a good, because there's no good me exercising once a week and expecting to eat a certain way. I've still got to up my game. So that was that concept. Do you want to answer the other concept about...
Richard said, does diet differ with age and gender?
Yeah,
so when it, as we get older, we know things change, and that's more to do with the hormones. So us men, after a certain age, we start losing a certain amount of testosterone. And the more testosterone we lose, the more estrogen we produce. So as we get older, we get the women boobs, we get the stomach, we lose the muscle mass in our legs and in our arms. So that's about hormone change. So it's about reducing the estrogen levels, and one of the great ways of doing that is cutting out refined sugar. That creates estrogen in the body. Then estrogen then creates its own fat.
Wow. See that there? So right now, guys, I've got the pasta bubbling up in there. I'm just going to throw these, because the broccolis, I don't really want them in the pot too long. Because these kind of things, you still want to have the goodness in them. So you kind of want to have them kind of like... I won't go as far as saying raw, but you want them. You don't really... You still want to have that crunchy feeling. So I put them in there to boil off on the pot. I've turned this off, so I'm going to transfer the broccoli into this in a minute. I then drain off my pasta. I then add everything with my coconut cream and crack on. So again, yeah.
Doretta says, whereas women, hold on, visceral fats around their lower abs and thighs.
So yeah, so women will hold more estrogen because you give birth, you do something else men are not capable of. You give birth here. So normally women will be, you know, hold the weight in the thighs, in the stomach. They come into more of a pear shape, is it? Yeah, more of a pear shape. So now, as you get older, what will happen, the levels of progesterone to estrogen changes. So it's about eating foods to support that change and to balance those hormones out, to keep them balanced. Because once out of kilter, it can lead to weight issues, but also emotional issues, like depression as well. There's good supplementations out there. But again, like I keep saying, nature's made no mistake when it came to our foods. So there's a lot of foods out there which help support the hormone balance of the estrogen, progesterone for the ladies. So eat foods which support that.
Guys, I'm telling you, when this guy gets his Zoom program, whatever, check in. Check in.
She also said hormone balance changes with age.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. It can change with age, but it can change with stress. So remember, there's 3 ways stress we can suffer from: stress, physical stress, emotional stress, chemical stress. So chemical stress could be alcohol, it could be medication, it could be recreational drugs. Physical stress could be physical trauma. I mean, exercise is a stress, but it's a good stress. And then emotional stress is obviously, you know, issues, everyday issues. So once we allow these to get out of balance, our hormones kicks out of balance as well. And once our hormone kicks out of balance, then it can lead to other problems like weight issues. So it's about controlling our day-to-day living and our emotions.
Richard said, what about men? How can they increase testosterone if it's low?
If men, right, probably a better conversation to have with your doctor, because I know it's getting common now. A lot of people are doing a testosterone replacement therapy with good results. So maybe that's as, if it's really... But how old are you first, Richard?
What's your age?
What's your age, Richard? Can you?
Yeah, you're typing?
I think so.
Right. But yeah, so weight training, protein, will help to raise testosterone and maintain what testosterone we have left as we get older. So strength training, eating natural protein, not the ones you find in a tub. It didn't come from nature. Remember, nature didn't make no mistake, because you turn around, look at the ingredients, it's like a science project. You can't even pronounce half of the words.
Doretta,
we just throw it in our body.
Doretta says, alcohol breaks down the body, makes it weak, so does not function well when you break down fats and stores it. And Richard says, I'm old enough, lol.
Right. Little alcohol can be beneficial to you. Too much alcohol, yes, then yeah, that will happen.
And she also says weight training compound exercises will help Richard.
Yes. Stick to the basics. Deadlift, bench press, squats, military press, chin-ups, dips. Stick to those basics and create a program where you can see the results. You're getting stronger every 6 to 8 weeks. Create a program from it, so you see you're getting the results, you're getting stronger from those exercises, which will help to maintain your testosterone and build muscle, which then lowers the estrogen for the men. Less chance of getting the women boobs and the mid-age spread.
A beer belly.
Beer belly.
So again, guys, like I'm saying, we're getting good information here, so make sure you're tuning in. Make sure you find the page. And guys, can you please share it, please? Share it. Share it to a friend. Share the page. Share the information. Once again, this is Breaking Bread. Safe place where we can share ideas, personal human development. And yeah, trying to help each other. Like he says, there's a few issues that we might be scared to talk about. But let's get that information out there, and let's start talking. Let's definitely start talking. Nice.
I mean, if you want to feel more comfortable contacting me private, if you've got any issues, then feel free to do so on the platforms which I mentioned before. I'm on Facebook. You can just sort my name, John Pommells, friend me, and then we can take it from there. Like I said, I would love to build a community where online, where we've got a bunch of us talking and not afraid to talk about our issues, because it's real. We're living real life, we're real people, real problems, but real results.
This is it now, let me just try this there now.
But as well, don't forget, read. Don't just feed your body, feed your mind.
And I mean, speaking to like the younger ones now, because I don't know what the age group is on this line here, but I got into reading when I was like in my 30s, because I wouldn't say because people say it's not cool, but I think for a lot of us, we don't see our role models reading. We don't see people reading, so we see it as like reading. That's what you do at school. You don't read when you finish school. So like you said, like. The biggest, like, why would you say to somebody, if you could give them one advice, why would it be reading? Like, why would you say to people, read? Because, I mean, sorry, I've got my own kids.
And sleep.
Yeah? You're sorry? You're asleep?
Sleep.
I've got my own kids, and I try and, well, I don't try, when I have them, I say to them, okay then, we need to read 1 hour a day. Within 10 minutes. But I say to them, go on the computer, or go on the phone, for 5, 9, 10 hours, you know? And I try and show them that, listen, like I said, the knowledge and the work, like I've said to my daughter, she wants to get into a lawyer. I said to her, right now, the technology that you have in your hand, you could find information on there where it's better than going to university.
Yeah.
Better than going to college.
Yeah.
I said, you could learn so much stuff on there. By the time it is time to go to college, you've already learned most of the stuff that you need to learn. But it's easy to do and it's easy not to do.
That's right.
You understand? Yeah, So going back to you again, talking about the book concept, why would you say to people, read more?
Because it can explode your life into change. Simple. Because these concepts and you're reading these things, it's putting these stuff inside your mind, these little seeds, which if you nurture them, can grow into something, meaning life change. So depending what you want to do with your life, whatever it is, how can you support that to make it real? How can you make it become true, reality? You need to get information. So when we're reading things, what you can grow from and apply to whatever it is you want to achieve, so you can achieve what you want to achieve. So when you look back in 5, 10, 15 years, your life's full of possibilities. It's not full of regrets, which a lot of people are. That's one big reason why you should read. So important.
So why doesn't like school push reading or like why is it that the average adult doesn't read a book after they finish school? Why is that?
Well, it depends as well. It can come down to what the value as well.
Okay.
So the value, some people don't value information. Or would they do, but it's the wrong information. Now remember, when we're doing something, nature in its wisdom, you created something called the fight or flight. Yeah, so when we're doing something which causes a certain level of uncomfortableness, like reading could, wait a minute, I could watch an hour of television, or I could read for 30 minutes. You're going to go for the path of the least resistance, which is watching television, because you need no effort for that. Yep, where reading, you need effort, you need to concentrate, you need to take in, you need to learn from it. That causes uncomfortableness for some people, so they'd rather settle for the easier. But like that saying is, easy come, easy go. So this is why maybe values is a big thing as well, what they value in their life. Some people value reading. I mean, I didn't value reading until I got the concept of reading when Dominic said read. I mean, even a few weeks, it took me a few weeks before, okay, let me get something here.
I asked
people, you know, about books and stuff, and that's what was recommended to me, Think and Grow Rich, Napoleon, and I started with that, and then all of a sudden a new world opened up to me. And I think I've been missing out on this for so long.
Yeah, of course.
then one book became two become three. Yeah. And I've got a little library. I mean, I've got over £2,000 worth of books at home.
Wow, look at that there.
You know?
The writer says, watch the chef though, go on.
Say again, sorry?
The writer says, watch the chef though.
Watch the chef? So you're not watching the chef? Thank you very much though, thank you. But, yeah, guys, like I said, what are we on now? We're 5 past, so I just took, just a little bit more than 10 minutes. And again, like I said, it's under the £5 value.
Seven minutes past.
I've tried to take away the concept of putting all the seasoning in there. So again, this is those fresh herbs that we're dealing with right here. Forgive me, guys, I'm kind of rushed because I know we're quiet for time. But I want to say thank you very much today for John. For visiting us and giving us the information, that's definitely opened my eyes again today. And I hope you guys, it's opened your eyes, and I hope that you do use your initiative and find this young man. And if you know anybody, doesn't have to be yourself sometimes, find somebody that could benefit from the thing that he's going to talk about. And the ideas that he has, and pass it on, definitely pass it on. Please share the page, please, if you can, guys, share the page. And we're back here again next Friday with a different guest. But like I said, I want to thank you to John for coming on today, for inspiring us.
Thank you for having me.
Definitely motivating us, and again, guys, just letting us understand the concept of trauma, and how a lot of us, we're always trying to find names for things, when really and truly all we need to start doing is just taking a bit more responsible for what's going on with us, and start looking at how we can change it. And it's about, once again, just understanding that these things, these underlying issues that we have, it's happening to all of us. So it's nothing to shame about for you to ask for help, or for you to discuss with a friend. And coming to a different solution. But again, guys, this is us there now. One second, just get a couple of thoughts in there. Where are we at? So again, guys, a bit of a nutrition. This is where we at. Here. Again, 10 minutes, 12 minutes long.
17
minutes there. I'm gonna basically fire at this cameraman here, mate. This cameraman is not with me. This cameraman is against me. You know what I mean? Never with me. So again, guys, this is Horace Jones, the Game Changer. It only takes a moment to change the game, right? Happy New Year to everyone. Remember, don't try and put everything in one basket trying to get all your New Year's resolution. I mean, they don't work. I mean, you crash and you give up. So again, start with one little goal. Make sure the goal is a small goal. Work on that goal. And then as the time goes on, increase the goal. But like I said, guys, start as small as you can. And then take it from there. Again, a wonderful night. I hope you've learned something today. And I hope you've caught something from here. So again, Horace Jones, the Game Changer. It's your game changing.